Welcome to another episode of the RAG podcast. And for those of you who don't know, the RAG stands for Recruitment Agency Growth. Since early 2019, I've been interviewing the most successful and innovative recruitment owners to learn how they rose to the top of their game. In season seven, I'm going to be having raw, authentic, and insightful conversations with agency owners, entrepreneurs, leaders, people across the industry. And I want to be learning about their ambitions, what's happening behind the scenes in their agencies today, and their plans to navigate difficult market conditions. I'll be bringing you the latest and greatest recruitment stories every single week on Wednesdays at noon across multiple platforms. Stay tuned. Welcome back to another episode of the RAG podcast. On this week's show, I was joined by Owen Myers and Jenna Mackey, the founders of Mackey Myers. Mackey Myers is a specialist accounting and finance recruitment firm headquartered in London, 2.5 years old with 14 employees. These guys are doing things in a really sustainable and very modern way of working. 2.5 years, they've doubled revenue year on year. They've introduced a four-day week after 12 months, which has been hugely successful. And they are now looking at growing from 14 to 40 to 50 over the next few years. They operate in 4 days in London. So they have no time from home apart from the fifth day on a Friday where they are completely off work. So it's 4 days in the office, 1 day off. In this episode, we talk about how they work together at Michael Page, why they set their own business up, the reality of starting a business just after the pandemic, and actually how good the years were in 21, 22, launching a four-day week, and everything that's happened in between. For anyone who's listening who wants to build a business in the future or is right at the start of their journey, this one's going to resonate because ultimately these guys are 2.5 years in. Everything's fresh, everything's real, and they're making it work. Okay, doubling revenue year on year is not an easy feat. So I hope you take notes and enjoy the episode as much as I did recording it. Without further ado, Owen, Jenna, welcome to the RAG podcast.
Thank you very much
for having us.
Pleasure.
Should be a fun session.
It should be on this beautiful, sunny Tuesday morning. For anyone who's watching this on a Wednesday, obviously it's pre-recorded in case they wonder if I've lost the plot. Guys, thanks so much for taking the time out today. I've obviously done a little introduction to you, but I can never do it true justice. So I'm going to start with you, Owen. Give us the bird's eye overview of the business. I don't want the story and any historical stuff, just people, location, sector, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, Mackey Myers, we've been trading 2.5 years. We are a finance and accounting recruiter predominantly. We've got an office based in London. We're office full time, but we'll get onto that, I'm sure. Our kind of core market really is that classic mid to senior market. It's like 50 to 150K sort of middle management, senior management level positions. We're hedged across multiple markets, and we do both permanent and interim as well. Mm-hmm. So we've been growing quite well and got a good bit of momentum behind us and looking to keep going.
Jenna, is anything you'd add to that? Has he nailed it?
I think he's nailed it pretty well, actually. I think the only little addition is like the focus in terms of market is predominantly SMEs, so small to mid-sized organizations.
Right. So the client base almost reflect yourselves. You know, you're not working with the huge corporates. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. So you two, tell me, I don't want to go into too much about your journey as recruiters, but we have to touch on it. Like, you worked together for a while, right? So tell Jenna, how did that all come about?
So how did that all come about? Basically, back in the day, I used to work in Michael Page St Albans office, and Owen used to work in the Michael Page London office. And for the first probably 18 months of my career anyway, we didn't even know who each other were. And then Owen ended up getting looped into jury service, and he lives in Hertfordshire. Right. So for 2 weeks, basically every day, when he wasn't in court, he was coming to the St Albans office. And I think I'm quite nosy, so I thought this was like a great opportunity to be like, what's jury service like? What's the case all about? Are they guilty? No, not at all. And yeah, we just got chatting, to be honest, for those 2 weeks quite a lot. And then about a year or so later, I was kind of debating my options whether to go Michael Page London or whether to go external somewhere else. And I was actually leaning towards leaving. And then Owen kind of tapped me up and said, what about coming to work for me in the division that he ran at the time? And then that's kind of where it all started, to be honest. But jury service was kind of, I don't know, the kick.
Where
the
it all began.
Yeah, yeah, wow. Everything.
Without going into too much detail, Owen, like what was the case like? Was it interesting?
I was on a couple of cases, actually. The first case, I spent a whole day to select the jury, and we started the case, but then we all got thrown out because they worked out about an hour in that was a conflict. So that was frustrating because you're just waiting. Anyone that's done it, they'll know you're just waiting around for hours before you actually have to do something.
I've never done it,
yeah. So I did one case, which was assault, and then there was another case as well. I mean, it's really intriguing. Like, I know everyone wants to kick the can down the road and do it another time, but it's quite an interesting thing to do, although frustrating because everything takes so long and the system's a mess and all that good stuff. But doing your civic duty and all that, it was good to do.
Good on you. And so you brought Jenna in, was it into the London office then for Michael Page?
Yeah, basically. I mean, you know, it's classic big business, right? So Jenna was working in St Albans. That's where she started. Bought a house in East London. But the division, like London and then the Northern Home Counties, didn't talk to each other. Suddenly we were going to lose someone because, you know, she wanted to work in London, right? And I was given the classic, oh, you can't talk to her. She's gone, you know, whatever. So had a bit of a chat and I think then my boss got involved and then we were working together. So we worked together then for about 5 years in central London, pretty much, before then my career took a slightly different curve to do, to run a different division. And then sort of one thing led to another.
So how did you guys bounce off each other then? Because obviously something must have gone well for you to start a company together. So what was the dynamic like working together?
I mean, it started off very much as like a work relationship, right? So sort of I was the manager, so I was running multiple teams, and she was basically managing one of those teams effectively. So it started off, but I think the way in which our division evolved, like it was one of those points in our career where it was like everything was like primed. It was a fantastic couple of years, and so we all became quite good friends off the back of it. So it was colleagues first, friends second, probably. And I'd probably say that's quite the good way around to run a business, because you've heard some horror stories of mates going into business together. So
I launched mine with my best mate, and we're still here. But
okay, fine. Exception rather than the rule.
I did buy out another best mate in year two, which was a painful experience. So we could, there's definitely, if you get the right one, you're fine. I think you can get it wrong on either side.
Yeah.
So how long were you working together when the initial idea of maybe something is going to happen in the future to set something up? When did that all start?
So we were still at Michael Page. Jenna was an associate director in the London finance business. I'd since moved to run the Northern Home Counties piece. So they had an office in St Albans, Cambridge, Milton Keynes and Oxford. And the way in which the business was going at the time, both of us, we kept in touch a lot and everything, were just getting equally frustrated with, you know, the political machine of a bigger corporate and getting more frustrated with having to, you know, pass down decision making and all this sort of stuff. So I think it was in a run up to Christmas, wasn't it, where I think I decided that I was done. You know, we had a couple of drinks, or it was a breakfast, I think, actually, and Jenna was in a very similar situation. So we decided to have a nice Christmas, reconvene in the new year. And at that point, the decision was we're both done with where we were, but didn't really have the risk appetite to set up our own company. I mean, I was an ops director. So I was, at that point, I was running about 40, 45 people. So I wasn't really on the tools. Didn't particularly have the confidence to go, oh, yeah, let's go and make some fees. But an opportunity came up through some connections that we had to go and work for another business to start their London office. So it was kind of a similar sort of thing, but very much a safe startup. So Jenna had some history with the guys that ran that business. I had a few connections. So that's how it first started. We left the big corporate to go to a small boutique to start their London office.
Did they know you were doing something in tandem, or was it that big that you handed your notice in and Jenna, you handed your notice in, and it was just two people left?
I don't There's probably like two ways to answer it. We both interviewed for this job separately. Right. And I think at the point where we both realized we were both done with Page, I think Owen was kind of like, well, why don't we just do it as a duo rather than like two people interview for the same job? And then propositioned the guy who ran the business to say, like, would you take both of us on to launch London together as two heads rather than one? So we were both knew we were done, and we were both interviewing at different jobs, and it just so happened that this one was probably the right job and the only job where maybe that was an option.
And how did you find out you were both interviewing at the same place? Was that a conscious thing?
No, it was a bit weird, actually. So I'd never really looked for a job in my 10 years at Page. You know, I was, you know, went into the business and, you know, kept taking on more stuff, and it was great. So because I knew I wanted to leave, I did a bit of shopping around, getting a feel for the market. And I said to Jenna, oh, I'm chatting to this company. And she's like, oh, I interviewed there last year. So it was kind of, it was quite organic from that point of view. And then it was a bit of a light bulb moment. And we thought, do you know what? Why don't we just give it a crack?
So, okay. So what year was this, Owen? When did you do this?
So that was beginning of 2019. So we started that job in like April, May 2019. So before COVID.
Year before COVID. Yeah. So you, like you say, you've had enough of the big corporate. You both take a job salaried, I imagine, to go and start a complete brand new business for someone who was established. Where were they already established?
So they had, up north, Birmingham, Manchester. They had about 30 odd people in the business, but dotted across a few different locations.
And how, to talk me through, Owen, how did that go? Because I'm trying to remember 2019. It was a pretty good year, I think. I think going into the pandemic was quite a strong time. So how did you guys get on with
that? Yeah, I think it was right. We did pretty well, to be honest. I think, quite quickly, well, we were sort of up there because they basically had lots of coverage, but like quite small teams. So they didn't have like big teams established in Manchester or whatever. So, but London, we were sort of up there as one of their highest performance offices very quickly. We'd made a couple of hires and momentum was like pretty good, to be honest. So it was going okay. Obviously COVID hit, which killed momentum. We still traded well, actually. So kept the head above water, and you know, the business sort of got through, and you know, the London business was the most profitable that year, and it was all good. But obviously momentum in terms of hires we had in the pipeline and, you know, business development that we were doing, that kind of, you know, obviously slowed down, which then kind of, you know, was a bit of a light bulb moment as to kind of the planning after that.
Jenna, what was it like working side by side as opposed to the previous Michael Page relationship? So you earlier worked for him in the, and then you swapped offices almost. He'd gone to the counties, you were in London. What was it like to suddenly sit side by side with a blank canvas, even though you're backed by others? How would you describe that feeling at that time in your life?
It was, to be honest, it was great, because I think we'd actually had essentially maybe like a year to 2 years where we hadn't worked together at all. Like you say, we flipped, basically. I was doing London, he was doing home county. So I think to be able to work back together in itself was like really exciting. And I think that for me was a big driver to leave Page and do that together. But also I think the thing that has been really good for me and Owen is, I think like morally we're very well aligned with what we want, our ambition, where we want to get things to. But actually our skill sets are quite different. And we, therefore, I think that's why we work quite well together, because he takes on certain parts of the business and I take on other parts of the business. And I think that came to fruition again when we joined the company after Page, that really demonstrated that actually it was kind of like yin and yang vibes that you could then work.
So how would you describe the balance then? So what is your strength, would you say, Jenna?
I would say if I look at our business like now, we probably divide it up between like people, sales, culture kind of sits with me. And I think when we first started, that included things like marketing and bits and pieces like that. And Owen's much more kind of like strategy, operations, finance. So And that's kind of like rang true, I think, from day one of doing this. And
so you make the money and he just stops you from spending it, basically.
I would love to spend more money, yes.
Me and my business partner, both sales, both ex-recruiters, and we both sell still, but we're definitely more aligned that way. Like, I'm the ideas guy and I'm always open to stuff and I can move, a plan can move through my head in about 30 seconds. I'm like, yeah, well, let's do it. And he's like, hang on a minute. And he sits there and he's much more, but he's better at seeing the financial impact across different areas and stuff. So it's been really useful from day one to have that balance in my business. That's clever. I like that. Did you know, and I think this is quite a loaded question, but did you know the day you started in that second business that was just a stepping stone? Was it always going to be, we're doing this to learn on someone else's money? Or was it genuinely you thought that might be your direction for the longer term? And I'll say that to Owen.
Honestly, no. So obviously we've had a few comments in that respect, but like, honestly, no. I think, you know, we went into it with good intentions. I think they had an interesting platform. I think the idea, I mean, you know, we were still quite young at the time, you know, we were 30, 31, you know, still had quite a long innings in us. The idea of working with that business through for a couple of cycles or something, that was quite appealing. So generally, no, it was really just the COVID factor that completely changed kind of perceptions and kind of our appetite to risk, which really just sort of gave us a bit of a kick and you only live once type mentality.
So talk me through that then, Owen. What happened? So I remember March 2020, we all remember the dreaded Boris Johnson moments. And I remember I lived in Essex. I don't know if you know, East London, Essex, Hainault, do you know that?
Is
I was living there at the time, and there's Fairlop Waters, which is just opposite where I was living, a big lake. It was famous on Towie. I saw it on Towie then. I lived near it. It's a bit weird. and then I remember sitting there. They had a little bar. And I remember sitting there and had a pint of Guinness to myself when the world was falling apart. And I remember thinking, is this really happening? Like, I remember just thinking, is this really happening? And I didn't drink again for a couple of months, and I got my head into it, and I felt like I had to get into like some kind of fighter mode because it was just horrific, right? So let's go back to paint the picture of what it was like for you. And you're in a business, you're just over a year, well, about a year in, you've made some progress, and then the world gets shut.
Yeah, I think the announcement was, Wade, you can't go to work anymore. And we didn't even take the plants with us, right? We were a bit like, oh, you know, we'll go for a pint, we'll be back in a couple of weeks. So it was you know, in denial. And then obviously when you're working from home, it obviously then went downhill quite quickly from there. I think the one thing I would say is I'm bloody glad we weren't running a business at that point, to be honest, because I don't envy anybody, whether they had an established business or a small business, of doing that job and trying to navigate that. You know, if someone's put 4, 5, 6, 10 years of their life into it, but that is really hard. So fingers crossed we've started at a point where, you know, we can get through a couple of cycles before something like that happens again. But from our personal point of view, we actually found it very difficult because it wasn't our business. And so we weren't really in control of all the information. We didn't really have great visibility. So you're going on a lot of trust on, you know, what's happening. I think that we had enough of a pipeline that actually we carried on working, and, you know, we were still sort of recruiting. Obviously it wasn't as much as it was, but we kind of kept going. But, you know, just as the business is trying to navigate it and us kind of being part of it, kind of not, felt a bit unsettling, to be honest. I think if you worked at a larger corporate, you'd kind of just go, well, you know, they've got big coffers and, you know, whatever, and, you know, things will be okay. But a smaller business, there was that slightly unsettling feeling. And I think that, you know, I was running quite a lot of the time because the weather was amazing, wasn't it, in April and May and June. And there was never anything that happened which sort of gave the indication that this would happen. But the thought process of, you know, how's the business going to do? Is it going to survive, etc.? I mean, it did, and it's fine, and it's flourishing now as well. But that kind of just then set off this trail of thought as to, right, what would I do, actually? And, you know, it was just going on this run. Then I was just like, do you know what? Why don't we just set up our own business, you know? And
how big was the London office at that point?
I mean, there was only five. But then we had a few hires, which then probably had four hires in total, which fell away because of everything sort of that was happening with COVID during
that
time.
Did you furlough the team? Did everyone work? How did you guys respond?
It was a bit of both, wasn't it? Yeah, it was a bit. So some people were furloughed, but then some that had sort of pipeline and portfolio that was still working sort of stayed on working. So.
And what about you, Jenna? So Owen's running around his local area, getting a tan and thinking maybe I'll do something different. What was going on for you?
Yeah, similar, really. I think, to be honest, like, I think the whole time that we were in that business, I think we were feeling, we'd kind of done it to do a startup within a business. And I think we'd always had a view that we would have like full ownership and control as to what that actually looked like, the business that we were running. And I think even pre-COVID, the longer that we went on working there, the more we realized actually it's still not us. Like, it's still the guy who runs the business. If he doesn't want to do something, he doesn't have to do it because it's his company. And you don't actually have that much control over your destiny, even though you're doing this startup in somebody else's company. Yeah. So I think, like, even in the run-up to COVID, we were probably both thinking maybe this isn't the kind of longer-term plan that we already had. And then, yeah, Owen went on a run one day and had this like brainwave and kind of rang me up later on in the year of going, do you know what, like, no job is that safe anymore at the minute. Like, I think that's just been proven that there is no like safe way of doing a startup, so why don't we just do it? And I think over the years, like, me and Owen had often, after a few beers, had a chat about running our own business and what that would look like, and we'd never really taken it, I think, that seriously until we'd left Page. And then again, we joined this company, I think, with a longer term vision that we would kind of climb up the ranks through there and maybe take over more responsibility for the business internally. And then this was just like the catalyst to go, well, we're not that safe anyway here. We've lost a lot of momentum, so we're going to have to start again from scratch. So actually, if there was ever a time to do it, like, now actually feels like the perfect opportunity to do that.
I'm interrupting today's episode to give you a message from our brand new sponsor. Now, this company are called Untapped, and everyone knows that Hoxo, through this podcast, I've explained that we've built our team internationally, heavily in South Africa, okay? And I get questions all the time from clients and people who listen to the show, like, how have you done it? What was the process, etc. Well, I've partnered with a business that can ultimately reveal it all, share it all, and help you do the same, right? Because look, it's been a tricky year for the sector, and many of people through uncertain times have had to streamline operations. However, you know, accessing low-cost resources internationally has proven to be a bit of a cheat code for some people, including Hoxo. But anyone who's tried it, like us, it's very difficult. A lot of work, process to get it right. So this company, Untapped, are one of the hottest companies in the market. They've helped Hoxo, they're helping our clients. And they specifically look at companies in the UK, US, Middle East, and Australia transition to using remote individuals and building full offshore sourcing and recruitment solutions. So they source talent pools from places like South Africa and the Philippines. And we're talking about experienced talent here. We're not talking about graduates with no experience. This is like people with 3 to 5 years recruitment experience, and integrate them into your UK team, okay? So they work remotely, but plug into your UK team. They put around 3,000 candidates per month through an intense 4-stage interview and online testing process to find the top 1% or 30 people and secure these people for work with recruitment agencies like yourself. You know, all candidates are benchmarked against UK competency frameworks and the way in which you would hire in the UK. So we're not talking about cheap for the sake of being cheap. We're talking about international, experienced people just living in lower cost locations. So it's a really simple process if you want to work with these guys. You pay a deposit to kick off their search. They then provide a candidate shortlist in 14 days. And then you can put people through your own process to hire them permanently, or there's a freelance option. So if you just want to try before you buy, they can employ them. You pay a daily rate and it's a freelance option. Untapped are totally transparent with all the salaries and fees. But, you know, we're talking about, you'll still pay about 70% less than a UK equivalent in that role. So it's a no-brainer to complement your existing team to handle surplus demand and ease cost pressures. You know, if you're not using this to rip up your business and rebuild it with global resources, then you're probably going to fall behind eventually. So due to demand and capacity, they're only operating on a waiting list right now. So if you want to be part of their waiting list, go to www.tryuntapped.com. Okay, www.tryuntapped.com, and check out their information. Make sure you say that you listen to the RAG podcast. because they'll do you a very special deal as well. Right, go and check them out. Back to the show.
It's incredible, isn't it, how that period of such uncertainty created a lot of entrepreneurs. Like, it created, yeah. I know, and really successful businesses since. I know, you know, I'm thinking about likes of Orbition, who I'm working with, Interval. These are brands that I've worked with since, and the guys are flying. And they all launched in like August, September 2020. Because you're right, we all went back to basics. We had no one else to rely on, and we actually, some of us did all right in that period and thought, you know what, if I can handle this, I'm ready for it. Now, again, how much of the recruitment had you done in that first year, Owen? Because you, again, I was nowhere near the level you were in terms of, I ran about 25 heads in Venquist when I was there after 5 years. And I didn't really do a deal for the last year I was there. I was just recruiting internally and managing people and doing BD. So that definitely played on my mind, even though I was the biggest biller in the company. I still thought, have I lost that candidate energy? Or, you know, I didn't, it put me off. And I think it's partly why we didn't end up doing it. We did something else because I fell in love with something I found the energy for. But for you, that year at the other brand, how important was that to get back on the tools and prove to yourself you still had it?
Yeah, really important, really energizing, actually. Because I think when I got to the point, I was like, I'm a bit done with Michael Page. Part of my thought process was, am I done with recruitment? Like, actually, is it that? But actually, I kind of convinced myself that actually, no, you know, I've been here a long time and whatever, like, I need to try something else, try a different company. And I think that was great because it kind of just like re-energized, you know, my enthusiasm for the job and actually being at the front line and, you know, winning business and delivering on business and, you know, offering, you know, services and advice and all that sort of stuff. Because previously my client facing work was more PSL reviews, going along to win pitches for junior consultants, you know, sort of bigger ticket account management stuff, but it wasn't really like delivery. But yeah, that sort of 18 months we did, was great and kind of just said to me, actually, you know, you're not too bad at this. So, you know, you could probably keep going for a bit. So,
I like it. Makes sense. So you come up with a plan. This was what? April, May, June, something like that.
See, it was during like end of summer through to kind of Christmas, I guess, because, you know, we still wanted to put in a good innings, I guess, where we were. But I think the nail in the coffin was the November, when it was kind of obviously going back towards the lockdown scenario. But in that period, we were just a bit like just bouncing some ideas around. So we're a bit like, okay, if we're going to do this seriously, maybe we come up with individual like mini business plans and then kind of like put them together and like see if they, you know, if, you know, genuinely if we do match in terms of our mentality and ethos and all that sort of stuff. So we did that and then started playing around with some branding ideas and all that good stuff. But then it was in the run up to Christmas.
We were like, you started in March, is that right?
March 21. Yeah.
So then when did you quit your job? Is it end of January?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's exactly what I did in 2017. So I had a bonus at the end of January.
Yeah.
And then had a month garden leave in February. And then we launched on March the 1st, 2017. Yeah. So I remember that exact journey. And it's weird because you're kind of going into Christmas knowing you're out and you've still got one more month to do. And it's not a nice feeling. I mean, no. You've got to focus on yourself. And the reason you're doing it is for your own benefit. But you know you're leaving people behind. You know you're going to, leave other people in a more difficult situation. Which, yeah. When you both handed your notice in, though, that must have been a traumatic day for them. my fellow Mancunians getting a call. Sorry, mate, we're done down here. See you later.
Well, because also it was like in COVID, like we were still in a lockdown. So everyone was working remotely. Like we weren't even in an office. So basically, you know, we pretty much like rock, paper, scissored it and Owen had to make the phone call. So
did he mention Owen had? Or did you have to then make a phone call and do the same thing?
No, Owen just mentioned both. Nah. And then, so within 24 hours, we then went and met face to face and chatted it all out and stuff. So,
did they try and change your mind and keep you, or was it a...
Yeah. I think if COVID hadn't have happened, I don't think we would have been there forever, but I think we wouldn't have been taking the plunge when we did. So I think they felt like they'd taken a risk on the two of us probably and invested quite a lot in that. And we were probably leaving quite prematurely, to be honest. But you can't change what happened, really, that instigated all of that.
And the name Mackie Myers, it's his surname. It's your surnames, right?
Yeah.
But again, in Manchester, there's a bar called Mackie Mayer, which was probably an interesting thing for them. I didn't know there was they were Northerners, but I remember when I first saw your brand, I was thinking, isn't that the bar in Manchester? The internal
new spin out. New spin out.
I know, yeah.
But we get it in our Google Analytics. So like, you know, every month when Google sends through your search analytics and all that, it's like, no, it's either they're searching for a recruitment or searching for a burger, right?
So, Well, do you know what? The exact time you're talking about, I was in London. I said I split with my ex in the June. I went home to Manchester. Went off to Ibiza for a bit, and then I rented a flat in town opposite Mackie Mayer. And I moved in there, and then I paid for this flat with like, it had like a gym and a football pitch and all these fancy facilities. And then November, 2 weeks after I joined, the whole thing went into lockdown and all facilities shut. So I'm paying an absolute fortune for a flat with no facilities that you can't use. And all I did was walk around Manchester every day with my dog. And that was my life back then. I remember it really.
Yeah, fun times.
It was. So tell us, paint the picture then. Mark, we go to March now. You've got the name. You know, how did you actually start the business? Because if I remember, it was April the 12th that the world opened up again. Because I remember going to London and went for a few beers in this freezing.
You
had to drink outside. Do you remember? I was like, I'd lost all feeling in my feet that day. I remember.
Yeah. That was our launch day. So we registered the business beginning of March. Basically, spent a month doing the setup and you know starting to do some stuff in the background. And then the public launch was 12th of April. So we didn't get much work done on that day because we were outside freezing, having a couple of beers. But that's what we did it. I think one of the things that really appealed to us about doing it, and we've done it completely ourselves, bootstrapped, is the actual learning that we did during that sort of month or two of, you know, how do you set up a company and a bank account, and how do you choose a CRM and configure it, and how do you set up the tech infrastructure? And everything we wanted to do was so we could bring people in and scale it rather than just, let's just do something basic to get off the ground. So that learning was hard, wasn't it? Quite fun.
In terms of systems and pros, who were the main suppliers you partnered with at the time that you think you'd recommend to somebody else?
So I think the number one, I think, is get a good accountant. So we chatted to quite a few different accountants because I'm really sure we knew we were going to do interim. So we wanted to make sure we had someone in the background that could support our scaling on that front from that point of view. We use a company called Azuki Accounts. You should get Poonam on the pod, actually. She's right. It's a husband and wife business. She was ex-FD at Spencer Ogden when they were scaling, and she worked for James Khan's businesses for a little while. And she does her own, so providing finance back office for firms. So they're quality. So we've scaled up what we do with them, obviously, over time, and as we've grown and temp business has grown and whatever. So I'll probably say that's probably the biggest win since we started, actually.
What CRM did you go with?
Vincere.
We went with Vincere. Are you still with Vincere now?
We are. Our contract's up at the end of March, so we're considering our options, the best way of putting it.
Well, as you know, they're a partner to this podcast, and right now we're talking. We know they've had some challenges since the takeover.
Yeah.
So I'm in a couple of weeks. I'm going live with another episode, live with the head of product. So if you've got any questions that you want me to bring to them about the product, about the specifics of not the support, but the nuts and bolts of the tool, then let me know, and I'll bring them to them, and hopefully you'll be staying with them. They've been very loyal to me, and I know there's been some challenges, but I think all the software has its challenges, and it's just
that's what we've learned. Like, you know, all software has its problems. I think we liked a lot of the stuff in the Vincere product, but I think what we've realized is actually there's quite a lot to it. So unless we have someone really owning it, nailing it, configuring it, getting the people to buy into it and use it, like, it's quite hard. Like, but some of the stuff they have is brilliant and has definitely been a differentiator for us in the market.
Yeah.
It's just how scalable that is, I think.
Yeah.
So. Fair. So talking, going back to the start, April, your first day, you get hammered and don't do any work. That's standard. That's what should do. How did the first sort of 3 months go? Like, talk us through, did you have an office? Where did you base yourself? How did you do it?
Yeah, we did. We wanted to be in an office. Neither of us had the appetite to do this from our living rooms and stuff. I mean, Owen had a young family during COVID, and I think he was absolutely desperate to get out of the house, to be honest with you. So we both very much agreed that we wanted to go to an office, but we just got like the equivalent of one of those co-working spaces. So pretty cheap and cheerful. And I think because it was April 21, most people weren't back in the office at all. So we got, to be honest, like, pretty much the whole place to ourselves to a degree. There were a few familiar faces, but not many. So I would say the first few months we kind of positioned ourselves like down the corridor of the co-working space where there was nobody else there and we could be as loud as we wanted. And basically like pulled up a list of however many contacts that we wanted to reach out to and just started picking up the phone, started meeting people, started generating work. And to be honest, like, had an amazing first month. Second month was not so great, but the third one was back on track again. So
you say amazing first month. Did you do deals in the first month?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Interim roles.
I think it was all permanent. Remember, permanent or contract. So yeah, all permanent. Yeah, it was good. It was really good fun. Like, we were just back to your roots, really, isn't it, of what you did when you first started recruitment. So yeah, it was a good laugh, and we recruited a lot of jobs together and stuff like that.
Those co-working spaces do not like recruiters, or do they? Like, I got banned. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm a recruiter anymore, but sales, when I went to Ibiza in that COVID, I was in a co-working space. I couldn't go anymore. They kicked me out. It was too loud. I'm like, all I'm doing is my job. They're like, can you not stop talking? I'm like, no, my job is to talk. And they're all just like typing away and really, really chill. I'm like, don't charge me the full price. Give me my own seat and then not let me use it. That's not fair. But I think WeWork's the one where there's a lot of recruiters and they just kind of get on with it. Other ones are really like, I'm not going to name them. There's one I went to last year. And again, you always felt like you were in trouble if you spoke. It's good that it was quiet.
Ours was all right. There was a couple of companies that did festivals, weren't there? So there's quite a sociable bunch talking about, you know, setting up suppliers for these various festivals around London. So it wasn't too bad. But we were on... we're in the white collar factory building on Old Street roundabout. Yeah. So, you know, it was a good spot. And I come into Liverpool Street and Jen is in East London. And so it was a good spot, to be fair.
And the early days are just energetic, right? You're just in, you've got this kind of exuberance of it's my own thing. And how quickly, did you have any like targets or benchmarks to then, because I know obviously, Owen, you were always talking about scale and growing a team. Was there some metrics in place that you said, if we go and hit this, we'll then look at hiring and taking it to the next level?
I think the first one was cash, to be honest. So, you know, as I said, like, it was bootstrapped. We put our own money in. And so it was just getting to a position where we felt like we had enough cash reserve to be able to then spend on more people. So I think right from the get-go, we felt like we were pretty risk-averse. We've become... less so in order to kind of scale a little bit. But it was, can we do some recruitment? Can we get some invoices paid? How quickly can we do that? Which would then...
How much reserves did you want to have, though? Did you have like a full year's of someone's salary or 6 months or 3 months? Like, how much did you need in your opinion at the time?
I think to start with, we were 6 months cash. So at any given point in the running of the business, do we have 6 months available cash? That was the starting point. The advice that we've taken from talking to people is that, particularly because we've got an interim business and the recurring revenue, that is quite risk averse. If we were perm only, 6 months is probably 5-6 months is probably about right. But our general position now is 3 to 4 months. Otherwise, we're probably
going
not
into COVID
driving
though,
the business fast enough.
I remember we had this like advisor in December 2019 who came into our office, right, and he said, you could be doing with more than, you need at least 3 months cash available, you know, and probably 6 months. I remember him saying if like a plane lands on London Bridge, and he gave us this like basically 9/11 version of the UK. And I was thinking, that can't happen, surely. This is December 2019. And honestly, at that point, I don't think we'd ever had more than 2 months available cash ever. So if we'd have gone into the pandemic a year earlier, my business would have died, without a doubt. And January 2020, we kind of had that mindset that, right, and luckily products and services and the things that we were doing, we had a really good start to the year, but we did have that capable amount. And then also we launched a training program which went off, and we ended up like doing quite well financially in the pandemic. But it's amazing how that one conversation, in the, it was like it was meant to happen,
Yeah.
Genuinely, we wouldn't have made it. Like, we would not have made it. And it's getting that balance right, like you say. I probably lean, even though I'm a risk taker, the thought of losing it all, that's a big risk I'm not prepared to take in a lot of instances. Yeah. So yeah. I think there's an element of being safe there. So when did you start hiring? How soon was it?
Well, I mean, we'd started conversations very quickly. You know, as soon as we launched, we got a few people pop their head up and, you know, quite interested and all that sort of stuff. Because we were getting quite busy operationally, so our hiring strategy was always to have a mix of experience levels. So if we can attract experienced people, fantastic. If we can't, we'll build it through graduates, because we've got a long, you know, track record and heritage in training, developing people, so we'd lean into that. Lucky enough, we managed to do both at the moment. But at the beginning, we were a bit like, we need some more resource to help us. So we actually hired some sandwich placements who started in September. So, I mean, hats off to Naira and Jack, because we hired them 2 months after launching. So why they joined us, I have absolutely no idea.
On a university gap year, is that what you're saying?
Between second and third year.
You said sandwich placement. I was thinking, what the hell is that?
Yeah, yeah.
Make your sandwiches. No. Yeah. All right. So they were never going to be able to do more than a year, but for you financially and for them, it worked, right?
Yeah. And also, we quite like the model as if you hire, you know, one or two sandwich placements, they might like it and might want to come back. And then you've got like a talent pipeline coming through. So, you know, we've actually just confirmed our last year's one, who's going to come back in September as a graduate. So she's a graduate, but then she's already got a year working with us. So that was kind of the general longer term plan. But short term, yeah, it was, can we get some additional resource that's not going to cost us a huge amount of money that can help us out? And then we made our first big hire sort of off in October. We started in January. So within 9 months, basically.
Okay. So at the end of the first financial year, so March, April 2022, what did the business look like?
Me, Owen, 2 sandwich placement students, and Ollie, I think it would have been. So,
and what did you build? Can you remember what you guys built that first year?
Owen's got the stats.
Go on,
Owen. Yeah, we did 450 in the first year. So I don't think we were breaking any records, but we were, you know, definitely in the, you know.
Yeah, but £450,000 working on your own. I mean, it's for you both. Let's say you're doing 220 take home each in Michael Page. You're doing pretty well. You'd have to be a big ass billow to do that, wouldn't you? So like, the reason I ask that question isn't to, you know, put you on the spot. So people, if they are listening and thinking about setting up, is hearing the reality from people that this is possible.
Yeah.
What would you say is the hardest bit about year one? Like, when you look back, what were the things that perhaps didn't go well, or mistakes you made in those early days that you'd look back and go, I'd do that differently, or someone should watch out for?
Supplier contracts. Read the small print. We didn't get burnt too much, but basically we signed one contract. I won't name their name, but we signed one contract. We thought it was a year contract. It was a 2-year contract. After a year, we just didn't want to use them anymore, and so I had to negotiate our way out of it. But all of the, particularly the tech products, all tech products, they have these, you sign up, there's like a 6-month notice, and then if you don't hand your notice, it's like a 2-year renewal. So just look at the small print. It's probably the first one. I think generally the hard bit is doing everything right, but also that's kind of the fun and the challenging bit. So so you wouldn't really go into it if you weren't really up for doing
it. What's
the
impact on your personal life? You mentioned that you had a small family, or Jenna mentioned you had a small family in that period. How did you balance that? Because that is I didn't have a family when I started my business. I do now, and I know how hard it is.
Yeah, I think, first thing, both Jen and I talked to our partners, like, before doing all this, as in, you know, making sure, like, well, not making sure, but getting their input, and, you know, whether they were happy, and, because whilst you put business reserves in, right, you know, so you can keep the business going, we obviously approached it on the basis of, I might not earn a salary or anything for 3, 6, 9 months, right, depending on when the invoice is going to land. So, you know, that's obviously a big impact on family to go into something that might end up like that. Anyway, so a very supportive wife is probably the first thing. But then also, we wanted to, one of the visions for the business was, you know, can we do something whereby we have ambition and scale and do something really interesting with meaning, but we're not rolling back the years to the 1980s culture of, you know, working 7 till 8 and, you know, at the grindstone sort of 5-6 days a week. So trying to
don't stand up all day in a pinstripe suit. Come on, that's easy.
Not today, anyway. Not today.
Take the chairs away.
Take the chairs away.
Here's a message from our newest sponsor in 2023, the Recruit Hub. Are you thinking about starting a recruitment business in the UK or the USA? If you've thought about it, if you've got any desire to start a recruitment business in the future, or you might have just started up and you think, am I doing it right? Then you can download a startup blueprint and access key information. Information relating to funding. How much money do you actually need and what are your options? Knowing where you stand, you know, what is your non-compete and do you have any restrictions you really need to consider? Do you need a co-founder? What do you need to know about going alone, going with someone else? How to automate your way to billing faster? Business planning basics, things like what is a business plan and how do you write one? And then how do you come up with a name and build a brand? Now, if you are interested in taking this document, our newest sponsor are giving it away for free. They are called Recruit Hub and you can get it at recruit-hub.com/startup-blueprint. The link to this message is in the show notes. So go away, get that free information and see if you're capable of starting a new business or the business you've just started, is it set up for success? Let me know.
I honestly heard a story from a recruiter that when he first started, they'd take your chair away if you didn't make enough calls. And then if you didn't make enough calls on the second day, the third day you'd have to wear a chicken suit. You'd have to dress in a full chicken suit. I'm like, that is just ridiculous. Like, it's not even, I mean, I would not work for a firm that would make me do that. It just wouldn't happen. But no. So you guys operate a 4-day week, right? Am I right? So when did that become a part of the plan?
Well, I guess, I mean, it started getting a bit of momentum, didn't it? I think in 2022, early 2022, I think there was quite a lot of press and articles and research and all of this going into it, a lot more in other countries. And then I think the UK rolled out their own trial of the 4-day working week. And we didn't do it via that. We did our own thing, to be honest. Yeah. We launched it, I think, just before the official 4-day week trial came into play. And I think we just kind of felt like it was gaining momentum and there was a lot of arguments for it. And it was a good opportunity to kind of, I think recruitment, like historically has been quite exactly like you've said, like outdated, like really long hours, crazy, like almost like punishments for not doing your job. Like just, we wanted to completely like get rid of that culture and mentality and we didn't want to be anywhere near that. So we thought that was quite an important factor in like driving the 4-day week. I think also it opens up the door to maybe like a few more, I don't know, equal pay for people that are working parents, like a lot of working mums, for example, like then don't have to take a deduction on their pay. And actually, what does it do for like work-life balance and well-being and culture and everything like that? And it was a trial, like we originally did it on
when
a trial.
Can you remember when you trialed it? What was the date?
April 2022. And I will never forget it.
A year on.
Right. Yeah, it was it was Easter and then all the May bank holidays. So I think basically for the first 6 weeks, people were doing like 3-day weeks and me and Owen were thinking, something's not right here.
What have we done?
What have we done?
That is the exact reason I changed my, because we started when you started on the March and we changed we did one full year of financial year, March to March.
Yeah.
And then the second year, I couldn't handle the fact that the start of a year, like bang, was easy. It was all these holidays. And I was like, I don't like it. So we changed it. We finished in December that year. We did a 9 month. We wrapped up the accounts. And we now run calendar year because that's how we worked in a recruitment firm, is calendar year. I didn't like Easter. So I can totally empathize with how that would go. And what is the operating model around it? Because we do a 4.5-day week at Hoxha. So we finish at midday on a Friday. And I love that. And the reason I kept the Friday morning, a bit selfish, but I've always loved a Friday morning at work. I think it's the best time. I used to go in on a Monday in my recruitment firm and say, if I could bottle the energy in the office on a Friday morning and release it on Monday, we'd be the best business on earth. Because everyone's in a good mood, everyone's buzzing. And I'm like, quite like getting to lunch. But after lunch, I'm like, I don't really want to work. So it's worked well for us that way. And do I actually finish at 12? No, but most of the team do. What for you guys, what is the operating model? Because there's lots of ways you can skin this cat. How have you done it?
There are lots of ways, and if it gathers momentum, different industries are going to do it very differently. I guess what we're doing is we are Monday to Thursday is kind of when we're working and being proactive, and we're all in the office as well. You know, those 4 days, we see that as a benefit as opposed to part of the job. And then basically, everyone's off on Friday, but are available for commercial imperatives, basically. So just like on a Wednesday evening, you know, if you get a call from a candidate or a client or whatever, you know, you're checking your phone and you respond, and it's important. So it's similar principle on a Friday. So basically people are off doing whatever they want to do, getting the train down to see family or, you know, going to the gym in the morning or whatever, but they're just around if stuff's going on. And
if a job comes in on a Thursday night, would you expect them to work all day Friday?
No.
Is that hard though? That must be really hard. Like, especially in contracts, because like I reckon honestly, some of my clients years ago used to just drop roles to recruiters on purpose at like 6 PM on a Thursday or 5:30 on a Friday. And I remember you'd be wrapped up, ready to go, and then you'd get an email from a client with like three other recruiters on it, going, "Just thought I'd drop this role out to you guys." And you're like, "You're taking a break." And you'd literally have to stay in the office and ring around and try and cover the market in 2 hours, right?
Yeah.
So if that happens to you now on a Thursday night or Friday morning, how do you, as a leadership team, how do you deal
with that? Yeah, I think the difference is that, I mean, we are focusing our business on, I don't know what terminology you used to use when you're in the industry, but you know, gold, silver, bronze, or ABC, right? Yeah, we don't do ABC. Bronze or C jobs, right? We don't do low quality work. You know, the fill rate is what, 8% or something like that, those sorts of jobs. And those are the sorts of jobs that are at 6 PM cover the market because they've already gone to 5 agencies. And we just steer clear of that business completely, to be honest. In which case we're doing quality work direct with decision makers. And the reality of the situation is on a Thursday evening, you know, they're not going to be able to organise someone to interview on Friday, like, because the candidate won't be prepped or they won't actually be that interested or whatever. So you know, if agencies are still saying they can fill a job in 2 hours in the level of the market we're doing, actually, that's not really how we see the market operating at the moment. Yeah. So it's just sort of managing expectations. And I guess, you know, people might do a bit of work on it on a Friday, but not much at all. And, you know, pick it up.
Have you had to communicate to your clients?
Yeah.
Did you put out like an email, or, and then do people reiterate it consistently when they're talking to customers about like picking briefs and things?
Yeah. We're very open with clients. I think, look, as I said, commercial imperatives, you know, there are times where clients are busy, right? You know, and they're like, I can only meet at 3 o'clock to do a briefing. You know, that's fine. You'll make time at 3 o'clock on a Friday to do a briefing, but that's the exception, not the rule. So, the other thing as well is that we considered doing, okay, Friday mornings, like you said, works for you guys. But actually, most stuff happens on a Friday afternoon because it's the end of the week. The client's like, right, let's get this sorted or whatever.
Yeah.
So actually, it's more do what you like in the morning. And, you know, you take a couple of calls on the Friday afternoon is generally how it's playing it out.
See, that's the reason why, because I'm obviously working with recruitment firms as my clients. If they have anything to do, it'll be on a Friday afternoon. So you're not going to get them anyway.
Yeah.
So I always find they're either in the pub or they're not replying. But on a Friday morning, it's just understanding your market, right, and what how people work.
Yeah. I mean, it's gone well. It's gone well so far. I think a lot of the feedback that we get about it is that, well, how do you fit it all in? But then actually, when you actually think about it, particularly post COVID, so, I mean, we grew up in the days where you'd be meeting at least 8 candidates a week in person in the office. Obviously, that doesn't happen anymore. You're generally teamsing them remotely. So that cuts down quite a bit of time. We're a small business, so you cut down all the internal meetings. Plus also, we're only focusing on quality work. So you cut down the time wasted on jobs you're not going to fill. It's very easy to make up 8 to 10 hours you know, which you can put onto a 4-day week. So.
And Jenna, so if we look at the second year, then you launched this, you've done 450 or whatever year one, which is brilliant. You've got a nice lean, small team with a couple of people due to leave at the end of the calendar, at the academic year.
Yeah.
How did the second year play out with this extra day, with a bit more breathing space?
Well, I guess, you know, like me and Owen probably don't get like the Friday off per se, but I think, like you say, like it, for us, it's a really good opportunity for like not being in the business and day-to-day plans and what are people up to and going out and meeting clients. So actually the Friday gives us the breathing space to work on the business itself. So, it's been quite nice. We kind of look at it as Monday to Thursday in terms of like, right, this is when we're recruiting, we're doing client work, we're doing people work, we're building the business. And then Friday is our time to kind of review, reflect, plan, put strategies in place, all of that sort of stuff, which has been good. And then the second year, how did the second year go? I mean, we hired another senior partner quite quickly who would have started in July. I also at that point went off and had a baby. So Owen was kind of running the fort.
I was going to say, you had a second year. 6 months were a complete blur for you, Jenna, to be honest.
Six months were a total blur. Yeah. I had like 3 months of just like reassessing my life and, you know, what have I done and all that crazy
what
thoughts.
What month
that
was the baby born?
End of June.
Right. So, yeah. So, Christ, that's a busy second year. So you're going in, you're going into the final trimester as the year starts.
Yeah.
And then you've got the baby. Did you take the rest of the year off? How did that go for you?
No, so I took basically like three and a half months off. Owen held the fort very strong, which was good and very helpful. And then came back early October, it would have been. But as Owen says, it was probably all a bit of a blur, a lot of sleep deprivation. But I left when the business was the numbers that I said, and then came back, and I think we probably had a couple more by that point because Hattie had joined. We'd replaced the placement students, and we had another person start as well. So
did the billings take a hit because you weren't there?
The business, no, like the business just shifted, I think, in terms of where we were making our money, because first year was me and Owen, to be honest. Like it was our relationships and our network that we'd built and were building. And then a couple of the partners that we brought in actually operated in a slightly different market. So I think the business just skewed from like where we were making money to more where they were making money. And then when we came back, it then started evening itself out again.
Amazing. I mean, I've got an 8-week-old baby today.
Oh, wow. So,
oh, very good. Yeah,
I'm right in the mixer of what you were saying. So it was
the depths of sleep deprivation.
Tuesday, the 3rd of October, she was born. And you know what? Sleep deprivation hasn't been the issue at this point. And I keep saying this, touch whatever. It's not even wood my desk. But she's all right. Like she is getting to sleep the hard bit. So I think last night was about midnight. But once she's out, we're pretty much maybe one wake up maximum. So I haven't really struggled so much with that. It's been more my wife's consistent energy for the baby than I've had to do everything. I'm doing everything else around the older two. They're my stepkids. So yeah. They're 8 and 10. And so my life has been like running, doing the school runs I never used to do, and I'm doing the packed lunches. I'm also cooking most evening meals. I'm trying to give my wife so much space to look after the baby. I'm just juggling in a very different way. But I mean, it's all worth it, right?
It's been
coming back after 3 months must have been, you know, again, you must have had a good support network to be able to do that. That's a.
For the record, I had absolutely zero interest in Jenna coming back after 3.5 months.
She emailed me before to say you forced her back.
No, I mean, I'd had two kids. I mean, they're 6 and 4 now. But having gone through that, it was quite a tough time for business. Obviously, you know, you can never plan these things. But equally, I kind of knew what it's like. So I was a bit like, I'm not sure 3 months is the right call, Jenna. But, you know, you obviously didn't trust me that much, so you wanted to get back very quickly. So,
Look, as long as it works for you, right? And that's the crucial bit. I just see Owen sat there thinking, Christ, any female listening to the show is not
going
to... No, you're not. All right, so we come to the back end of 2022.
Yeah.
And look, let's be really honest. It was a bloody good year, 21 and 22. They were good times. See, when you started the business, it was rock and roll for the recruitment industry. How have you found this year? Because I would say it's been a complete mixed bag across industry, across different clients. I'm working with over 500 recruitment firms right now. And I put a message out yesterday to about 100 consultants on a live call. And I got a complete mixed bag. I probably got 60% saying it's still quiet, it's still tough. And a lot of others with green shoots. But it hasn't been 21, 22 for hardly anyone. So how have you guys found 23?
So I think, we've found it difficult, but we've done well. So, we doubled the business GP year 1 to 2, and we're going to double it year 2 to 3. We would have taken that. The permanent market has felt quite sticky. So it's very hard to get a placement over the line, much harder than I think it's ever been for our whole careers. But I think the fact that we've focused on quality work as much as possible, we're not chasing our tail and wasting our time on stuff. And generally we're doing good work with good clients and good partnerships. Interim has been busier this year, I think. And so that's grown quite a lot. We've managed to get to the holy grail of our interim business is more or less covering our costs on day one of the month.
That's amazing.
So that's been really handy, and it's mean we can be a bit more aggressive with hiring plans and things like that. So yeah, no, it's felt difficult, but we've done all right, to be honest.
Do you know, without going into exact details, like rough profit margins you aim for, just because this is a conversation that I'm seeing such varied opinions on right now in terms of what does a good look like for a recruitment firm from an operating profit?
I think we're aiming for 20 to 30% generally. And I think that seems to be about right. We're in quite a, finance and accounting market is not the sexiest in the world. You know, it's not particularly boom and bust. So it's quite a safe market, we feel. I mean, it's always in the top 10 of, in-demand skill sets. It's never the top three, but whatever. So I think there's a consistent supply, there's consistent demand in that market. And I think historically, when you look at businesses, getting to 20, 30% is about right. And that's how we've been running the business. So,
brilliant. I mean, honestly, a lot do sub 10. A hell of a lot do sub 10.
Oh, really? Yeah.
I know some that are 50, 60%. I interviewed one last week, said he's been 60% since 2017, which is incredible. I mean, there are only 8 people still, and they're doing some big numbers. But majority who are growing at the pace you're talking about, that, yeah, sub 10, which is, when you stop growing, that's when the profit will climb, right? So where are you guys at right now? How would you describe where the business is today? Like, what's the general feeling? And Jenna, I'll ask you, how would you describe where you are as we speak at the end of November 2023?
So I guess, like, stats-wise, we're 14 heads, and the business is split, like, straight down the middle, 50% interim, 50% permanent. So I think we've got, like, quite a nice little synergy in terms of, like, operations and how that's all structured. Mm-hmm. And we are incredibly female-heavy. I would say I think we're probably about 80% women, 20% men, so could do with some few more men, I would say. But culture wise feels great. Like, we put so much, I think everything that we've done when we set the business up was always to focus on experience, and that's the experience that you can give a candidate and client from a recruitment perspective, and make sure that, like, you kind of, like, flip the reputation that recruitment has on its head, so that people are, like, seeing it as a positive experience. And then the same to reflect that internally as well, which is part of why we've done the 4-day week. We focus a lot around, like, team incentives, not individual incentives. And to be honest, we've, like, focused very hard on, like, hiring, like, good people that you want to work with. And I'd say so far, 2.5 years in, like, that hasn't changed. And I think we've been very fortunate and maybe very focused on hiring the people that we think are the right people to fit into that culture and that ethos of the business. So I think things feel pretty good, to be honest. I think like money's going in the right direction, people are going in the right direction, promotions are starting to happen, which is great 2.5 years in. So
how much of the business billings is reliant on you two now?
Becoming less and less, to be honest. like in terms of recruiting actual jobs end to end, a very, very small amount. Mm. And actually we're getting to the point where like our grads are starting to become more self-sufficient. We've got our partners who are completely self-sufficient. So I don't know. Owen might know percentage wise better. This is kind of more his fault.
I think year one it was like 98% Jenna and I. I think year two about 60%, even though Jenna was off for a little while. But year three, I think job generation aside, but actually fees end to end, probably only going to be responsible for about a quarter, I'd say. Yeah. So it's going in the right direction, because then, you know, business becomes a bit more robust, hopefully, over time.
100%. So Owen, that leads me into my final question. Where yep. are you heading? Like, what's the vision? What are you striving for?
Good question. We found this quite a difficult question to answer when we first started talking to people, because most of the startup recruitment market very much plugs the "we're going to sell in 5 years" mentality, which obviously is a complete load of rubbish, because
you're going to sell
0.04% actually transact at any point. So we didn't really want to bring people along to some false narrative, right? So, you know, one of our core values is authenticity. Mm-hmm. Our kind of general starting point was, let's build a good business that, you know, has an impact and, you know, supports people achieve what they want to do in their lives, right? So that was kind of like one of the key things. In reality, what that means is phase one was, can we make some fees and hire some people, which we did. Phase two is 5-year strategy. Can we get to a business which is knocking out about 3 million, probably translates to 20, 25 heads. But we're already above the curve in achieving that. So we're now sort of just putting structures in place, like, okay, what's phase three strategy? And part of that, we think, depends on our own personal appetite. Also part of it depends on the structure of the business and the people. I think where we're heading really is a 40 to 50 person business, 2 million EBIT. That feels something which is, at the moment, achievable, realistic, and, you know, a point where we're not necessarily going to have to work all holidays and weekends. So that's
I love it. Well, I think you should be a politician, Owen. The way you
a politician? Oh, sure.
You're so clear with your communication. And that is a genuine, and I mean that genuinely, that is just one of the most simple ways of explaining where you're heading that I've had on the show. So well done. What I would say about you two, and I mean it, is you come across as such genuinely nice people, right? You come in and you want to do things the right way. I think what I love about our sector is actually most of the great businesses are not ran by people that people would think. They're not like these really super aggressive, overly obnoxious characters. They're actually just, you know, people that did a good job for someone else and decides they want to do it for themselves and take all the things they've learned and the best bits of here, there and everywhere and stick it together. And I think you guys are a testament to that. You're doing it. So firstly, well done. If anyone's listening and just likes the sound of how you've gone about it and wants to pick your brains on the 4-day week or whatever, how you don't let anyone have any maternity leave. that was a joke. But honestly, if anyone does want to reach out, are you open to a chat with them and just giving them some time to help them out? Yeah, for sure.
Do you know what? One of the really refreshing things when we got to do this was that actually, you know, the recruitment, the SMB market in recruitment, like, is so welcoming and supportive and wanting to give advice. So we definitely got that and reached out to people we knew. And even now, we've started supporting people and giving them some ideas and whatever. And it's really fulfilling. So yeah, very happy to share the benefit of our experience if it can be useful.
And if anyone in your hiring, right, if anyone's interested in joining a business that's 4-day a week, you know, a mature culture, London, where about you in Old Street?
Shoreditch.
Yeah, so reach out and hopefully people will listen and be like, you know what, that's a business I want to work for. Guys, thanks so much. I'd love to get you back on in the future. Let's see how you're progressing along that journey. And I wish you the best of luck.
Very good. Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.
Thank you as always for listening to today's show. I truly hope that you got value from it. Honestly, it's the only reason I take time every week to ensure that my audience, you guys, future and existing recruitment owners, you're learning from each other to make this industry that I love so much stronger. And today's episode is brought to you by my business, Hoxo. I'm the CEO and founder, and we're on a mission to help brand recruitment agencies and their people better. I want to help
people have the tools to stand out in the most competitive markets in the world. We're currently working with over 350 recruitment agencies and 5,000 of their consultants right now, helping them to build their personal brands, to consistently win more business, attract talent, and just become that go-to recruiter in the market. Now, we do have a huge coaching program, but a lot of people don't know we also manage the brands of a lot of founders, and we can do the rebrand of that company organizational piece as well. So if your recruitment agency either needs help to look and sound exactly how you want it to, or your leadership and consultant level need to get out there and drive more traffic back to that website, to the business, and start using LinkedIn to generate more revenue, then you should definitely be reaching out to us. If that sounds of interest, please do visit www.hoxomedia.com or drop me, Sean, a personal message on LinkedIn. I love hearing from RAG listeners. I would love to talk to you. Look forward to it. So I'll see you again next week with another episode. Catch you soon.